Barbara's extraordinarily beautiful book, Hound Mouth. And if I turn it over for you, you'll just see that beautiful cover wrapping all the way around there. It's such an extraordinary, extraordinary book. And I find it absolutely unfathomable. I think Lifecan are incredibly lucky that this is Barbara's debut collection, because Barbara seems like the wisest of old hands in the sense that she writes with such brilliance. She has such a following and so much respect from our poetry community that I think we have absolutely been incredibly lucky to have the opportunity to publish her debut. Barbara was born and raised in Canada and had a career as an actor which has spanned the UK and Canada. She came to London in her 20s. She's now based here, but still going back and forth across the Atlantic. Her poems have appeared everywhere: Poetry London, Butcher's Dock, Ambit, Under the Radar, the Brixton Review of Books, Magma, Poems in Which, Perverse, The Alchemy Spoon, South Bank Poetry, and in many anthologies, including the Indigo Dreams anthology for The Silent, Crooked Jukebox, Invitation to Love, The Cry of the Poor. She did her MA through the Poetry School and Newcastle University. I think there's some alumni from that MA here tonight, so a big high five to all of you. That MA is producing astonishingly good poets, but I thank our lucky stars that we have pounced upon Barbara and we are publishing her debut. So Kirsten, if you're there, I'm going to pass over to you and ask you to just say a few words about Barbara's collection before she reads.
Hey, Helen. Hello, everybody. Just quickly, if it's okay, just wanted to say a couple of words about judging overall of this competition. I wanted to thank Helen very much for inviting me and trusting me to this competition, because yeah, I understand that if somebody lands you with three books that are either too similar or are not what Life Canon is about, then it's a real sort of like, that's gonna be a real challenge. Luckily I landed with a shortlist that was absolutely packed with fantastic books, and so I knew it was going to be good. That was a relief. One of the frustrations that pops up again and again in prize culture in general that I find is the fetish, I think, sometimes for poetry and poets that can be neatly summarized, packaged and branded, and it's not really the kind of poetry that sparks response for me. I like work that dodges away and then kind of waits for you to catch up and then darts away again. And there's a balance to strike there. If a piece is a bit too obscure and self-regarding, you can't really begin a conversation at all. So down the other end, if a poem can be summarized in a single sentence, you really have to ask what business it has being a poem in the first place, as opposed to an article, a story, or any other form. Weird, ambitious, beautifully wriggly poetry does break through from time to time. And Life Canon are unsung heroes in driving it forward. So when I got the shortlist, it was hugely varied, as I've said, a huge range of themes and styles, and a sense of play to it. And that really sang to me. And it was an absolute joy to read and reread them, take them all around with a bundle, and make that difficult final decision. I was very glad I could pick more than one. So thanks again to Helen for trusting my judgment and to the poets whose work I got to read. So I'd like to say a bit about Barbara's book, Hound Mouth. So Hound Mouth turns life into a theatrical tour. It stops sometimes at warm and welcoming spaces and sometimes at bleak theatres with hostile audiences nursing threats. Revealing that our show came to an end where the road did, Barnes takes the reader back and forth across the Atlantic, pausing for intimate moments with mothers, partners, children, friends and strangers. And even the makeup artist preparing the speaker for a show gets to access a certain vulnerability in their subject, even as they cover them in an entirely fresh persona. I really love the vulnerability and what is left unsaid in Hound Mouth. It's those magical little pauses between actions, and it's as if you're watching a set change between numbers on stage. So Barnes leads us on this incredible dance between wealth and poverty, from the workhouse boy right to the queen herself, and then through innocence and experience. And every time you learn something new and remember something new. The empathy and darkness I found in these poems is so genuine and it's fully embodied. It really gets right into your bones. So very much like to welcome Barbara, and I can't wait to hear these.
Thank you so much, Kirsten. I'm going to hand over to Barbara now to read from this brilliant collection. And at the end, we'll all unmute and applaud wildly.
Thank you so much. Wow, what an introduction. Helen and Kirsten, you both mentioned luck a lot, and I feel like the luck was all mine that brought me here today. And that everyone's here, it's just so great, and I'm really moved actually to have so many people from different parts of my life, all in little boxes on my screen. Thank you so much. So you're sitting on a park bench, and this character, this raconteur, comes up and sits beside you, and they start to speak. This is Hound Mouth. I'm the sound of a dance hall fire, rocketing stars into the Toledo night. Everywhere you listen, I've a song to fill your bucket eyes. I'm the flood of 37, my glass puckered up and gorgeous as a Mississippi sunset. Meet me on the 14th floor of a park bench. We'll lunch with a pool shooting monkey. I rehouse the rhymeless, paint oranges on their door hinges. The scent of jasmine haunts the silver wreath about my face. Here's a case in point, and I'm skating on it. Once I knocked over the alphabet, and only the lonely picked it up. Buy me a ticket to space so I can toast the Titanic with the first spent bourbon bottle to rattle through Mars. I'm more than sodden. I'm uptrodden and washed down. Good night, sweet pirates of old blue. The current carries my graceful crimes. So it's really quite recently that I became an actress and a poet. Before that, I was just a poet. I mean, no, just an actress for a really, really long time. And I spent a lot of time grappling with this, with the allure of the limelight, which was quite perplexing because I'm actually a very shy person. So now that I am a poet and an actress, I get to write about this. And now the limelight is something that both lit theaters and also destroyed them. And the same can be perhaps said about actors. This poem is in three parts. Something about the limelight. One, it is neither green nor fruit. It is the night torn open, a white wound, a torch probing the hermit's cave, a wizard's hat and a dunce cap. It is a phantom lover with a hot embrace, an adrenal spill. It's your fancy man picking you up in his Porsche, the top down, a beckoning ghost, a pushy ghost, a tunnel you can't hide in. Your dealer lighting up in a blackout car. It's the white pill that can swallow you, a sweltering tent in the desert dust. It's the latest device playing a soundtrack of coughs and sweet rappers, a blank page at midnight, a fat fleck in dark paint. It's the bit nightfall missed out, the pause button on forgotten, your thin pie slice of forever, a bone dry puddle, stand in it. Two. Ching Lao Loro, contortionist, steadies the flame towards quicklime. A beam sears the length of Herne Bay Pier. The town's upright and curious, lean in close, craving the evening's bill, its promise of crude delights. Legs in a crippling twist, one arm pulls the other through the hole in his back. Professor Ching is swallowing his own head. His elastic lips whistle melody of robin, wren, greenfinch. A fierce dawn sparks and burns through blackness. Hard lit, Ching's expression is a grim white slick. In the pin drop pause, he recalls his limbs to their proper position. The crowd thunders, blinks to find he is Buffo sitting 20 feet up upon air, upon nothing. To which region of the spirits of darkness does this trickster belong? The sheen of those satin pajamas visible from Margate, from Whitstable, from the dim moon, if there is one. 3. From Kate Claxton to her leading man who perished in the Brooklyn fire, the Brooklyn Theater fire of 1876 during The Two Orphans. Darling H, you missed your cue. Memories spark. The pause grew hotter. Your untimely dry fanned panic. I went off script in our sellout hit, soliciting calm from the hazy stew that simmered beyond our bright box, our boathouse on the banks of the Seine. There is no danger. The flames are part of the play. I lay center stage on my bed of straw. Red raindrops, big as a man's hand, fell from a torn flap of sky, licking along the border lights. You were leaning over me. I recovered the scene. I forbid you to touch me. I will beg no more. Flood's alley overflows with the defeated, melting the snowdrifts. The overcoat you ran back for hangs on you like a crisp shroud, your face pieced together in the dressing room mirror. I wait for you in Washington Square, a blind orphan costume in rags, your thin blue flame. I'm Kate, the fire jinx, crying out for a prompt. We must act. We must cut this act, rework the ending. Danger is everywhere. The theater consumes us. I beg you to touch me, then it's your line. In the silence, I burn. So, the last 2 years. Well, I am, like a lot of people, I spend a lot of time, it seems, trying to bring the outdoors indoors and filling our home with far too many plants. And this poem came out of the sort of peak of that period and was also influenced by my unexpectedly newfound dependence on the show Strictly Come Dancing. Amaryllis. In November gloom, I brought you home. Inseparable threesome bound as you were in green. I left you on the sill, sightless heads bound to the scant sun as if in prayer or a teenage sulk. Dusk fell and your pout cracked a red stain. I'd seen girls like you in foreign films, the plain, pious daughter crossing the courtyard under flapping sheets, sharp cut to the dance hall, camera pans, zooms tight on flushed cheeks, the technicolor smile. By moonlight, you began your scarlet unfurling, frocks toppling over heads, that easy muscle of girls moving to heart tempo, the bass beat as petals surrender one by one into flounce, from the fiery core of each bellowing skirt, thin yellow arm straining up and out, the way lovesick fans pulse at the apron of a stage, the band coming into shape through smoke, lead singer tilting the mic to his parted lips, backup stoking more heat. Ready, girls? Are you ready? A 1, 2, 3. I also seem to spend a great deal of time going through my stuff and sort of discovering things I didn't even know I had. And it seemed like it was a time when objects took on a real significance. Silver heart. Most nice girls had one. A gift for birthday or Christmas, before a watch after dolls, kept for best in a blue velvet box, dull and important, like growing up might be. It daintied my blank chest. Bored, I would slip it past my lips, my tongue tracing the outline of this fancy lozenge, the embossed front, smooth back, flipping it over and over, letting it dangle in the gully behind my gums, the cool metallic taint, a taster lesson in the alchemy of kisses. When my fingers worked along the heart's edge to prise it open, so I could keep my tiny yellow grandmother and my half my terrier there until I had a lover or twins, my thumbnail got stuck, ripping to the quick. Still, the catch wouldn't release, and a rage was lit, swift and deep in me. I bit down hard, and my back teeth left two dents visible only on the smooth side, marking it forever as mine. And before I get to sit back and enjoy Becky and Dino's wonderful poems, I just want to thank Kirsten and Helen and the Live Canon team again. And also I really want to give a special thanks to Tammy Yoseloff and Glenn Maxwell, who were very instrumental in bringing Hound Mouth into being. And I want to thank you all for coming here today and this evening or this afternoon or whatever it is, and celebrating with me. I'm going to leave you with a glimpse of a Northern Ontario summer. This last one is called Motion Capture. Summer in Nipissing, Milky Way covering up the dark. Lying next to me, you say, poor Ursa Minor, nightly cast in a lesser role before a gawping crowd. Little bear stuck still, way upstage on that black backdrop. So we unpin him, fasten his seven stars to the soles of your feet, your hands, belly, chest, forehead. Then you charge through hemlock and spruce, roar across Lake Tomogamy. And I'm blinking like a stop frame camera, crazy with fear that I might one day forget what you look like. Thank you.